stories of Mengele and the experiments he did on children, on twins particularly. And so she used to mention that to us growing up, about Mengele's experimentation on twins. So somewhere in the back of my mind was, you know, the living with, even though I wasn't a direct survivor, every one of us is a survivor in some way.
Did you ever see the Eichmann trial? Did you watch it?
I don't recall if I watched it. I recall reading that book a number of times in order to teach it and discussing it in class. And reading Raoul Hilberg's book was really most devastating because of the meticulous detail about the destruction of the Jews. And of course the issues that are raised about how could such a thing happen and the world not act. And then to be confronted with a person who said that the government itself was, U.S. government was harboring Nazi war criminals. And what was particularly troubling was that this was a non-Jewish person. And what was troubling about the fact that he was non-Jewish was there must have been Jews who knew about this. Why didn't they say anything? And also, why was he singling me out? He somehow suggested or intimated in the course of our conversation that the reason he came to me was that he saw how I had questioned the immigration commissioner. I guess I must have been an earlier time giving the immigration commissioner a hard time, you know, really asked searching questions. And I guess he saw that I was somebody who wouldn't be intimidated about trying to get to the bottom of this. Anyway, I did after the man told me the story, and even after discussing it with my staff, and we came to the same conclusion, it couldn't possibly be true. I couldn't get it out of my mind. And sometime later in the spring, there was a hearing, normal, standard hearing, probably about the budget for the Immigration Service. And the immigration commissioner was there. And I asked him, I said, well, listen, I'll just ask him. What's the harm? I'll ask them if they have a list of Nazi war criminals. Well, I asked them the question. I said, is it true that there's a list of Nazi war criminals living in the United States that the Immigration Service has? I surely expected him to say no. And he said, yes, we have such a list. Well, I almost fell off my chair. I couldn't believe it. They have a list? So then my next question was, well, so what are you doing about it? And then I got a smokescreen of words, gobbledygook, camouflage, dense number of words designed to obfuscate that nothing was going on.
Was there anti-Semitism in the INS?
Well, I'm sure there was anti-Semitism in every agency of the government. I can't single out one. I mean, probably less than there had been before. I mean, I think we're getting less anti-Semitic as a nation as time goes by, but so I said to the immigration commissioner, I said, well, I want to see all the files. I didn't know if I had a right to see the files, but I wanted to go and find out what was going on. So I said, I want to see the files of these people on the list. For some reason, the files were in New York. And so I came back from Washington. I used to come back every weekend. I came back and an appointment was made for me to go and examine these files in a federal building in downtown Manhattan. I didn't have any staff with me, I just went myself. And I looked through file number one, and it started allegation, allegation by X, Y, and Z that so-and-so was a police official, I think in one of the Baltic countries during World War II, where he was responsible for the execution of the Jewish population of a certain area. And then I go on, I read, what does the Immigration Service do about it? They send somebody to this person's house, they knock on the door, according to the file, and they say, how is Mr. So-and-so's health? He's very well. Thank you very much. They close the door, and they go home. They put that in the file. You have the allegation, someone's responsible for mass murder of Jews, And what does the Immigration Service do in response? They go and they check on this person's health. So, what's file number one? Maybe this is an aberration. I go to file number two. The same thing. Different allegation, different person. Same response by the Immigration Service. They go knock on the door. How is this person's health? That's it. I went through about, I didn't go through 50 files. I didn't need to go through 50. I went through 10 files or 15 files, and basically the same thing. In other words, the allegations were there, and the Immigration Service was doing nothing to investigate them. Nothing. Well, I realized what had to be done. I sat down, worked, and said, well, how should we really handle it? How should the government handle it? I said, there's got to be a special unit created. There's people who have the expertise to conduct an investigation. They have to conduct investigations. They have to go all over the world to find evidence. And so I had a press conference, and I laid out a plan that I thought the government should follow in terms of bringing these Nazi war criminals to justice. That was in 1974 in April. Of course, if you think about Watergate, because I was working very hard on Watergate at the same time. We held our hearings in July, so this was just a few months before the final hearings on the impeachment of Richard Nixon. So here was another government cover-up of vast illegality. I mean, there were so many things that occurred to me at the time. Well, why did this happen? Why did the government allow them to come here? Who was responsible for this? But I said to myself, the most important thing now is to find out how many Nazis there are and bring them to justice. We can find out the history later. We can find out how they got here and who was responsible. But how can we bring these people to justice now? And what can we do now to the Nazis living among us? That was my first and primary objective. What was interesting at that time was, of course, this was before the Simon Wiesenthal Center existed in the United States. This is before you had the Holocaust Museum. This is before it was very much conversation, discussion about the Holocaust in the United States. But, I mean, I didn't care how many people there were going to be out there supporting me on this. I didn't take a poll before I started this. This is something that had to be done. This is a wrong that had to be righted, and justice had to be done here.
And where did you find support, or where did you find opposition?
Well, there was nobody wanted to go on record in support of Nazi war criminals. So you can't say there was opposition in a traditional sense, such as, well, I want to have a tax cut of $1 billion. No, I want to have a tax cut of 500. No, you're wrong. Yes, you're wrong. Whatever. There was no such debate about this. The first thing that I did was I called for the creation of a special entity wholly and solely directed at bringing Nazi war criminals to justice. I also called for the U.S. government to search for documentation everywhere in the world. Turned out that we were not asking. Not only did we not want to ask, but we hadn't asked any country behind the Iron Curtain for any documentation since Nuremberg. We hadn't gone to the State of Israel. We hadn't even gone to the Berlin Document Center in many cases. There was no worldwide search. Remember, the Nazis were pretty methodical about the destruction of the Jews, so there wasn't always a lot of evidence left about who did what when. You had to make a worldwide search for this information. Government wasn't doing that. So those are the things that I asked to be done.